Hello everybody, this is biochemistry review series BRS part 2, and in this I will be talking to you about lipoprotein metabolism and important core aspect of this metabolism I will be discussing you. And for more detail of this metabolism, you can refer my book Concept in Biochemistry with Clinical Approach, chapter 18. So when we say lipoprotein, we mean to say the chylomicron, VLDL, LDL, HDL and various remnant particles. These metabolisms are very important for you. Individually, they can be asked to you as a long question or as a short note. So when we say chylomicron, we come across a big lipoprotein, huge lipoprotein, which is having lot of triacylglycerol, which is dietary, which is exogenous or dietary in origin. And also we have cholesterol ester, which is again exogenous. So whatever lipid we eat, the triacylglycerol and the cholesterol ester is getting digested in the intestine, and once they are absorbed in the GIT mucosa, they are incorporated into the core section of chylomicron. It is important to remember that we have B48 and ApoE on nascent chylomicron, new chylomicron. This chylomicron, when it comes to the general circulation, it is matured with the help of HDL particle, and HDL tend to donate ApoC and ApoE. So existing was B48 and E, and after donation of C and E from HDL, this chylomicron is not said to be a mature chylomicron which circulates in general circulation. Then what happens? It activates one endothelial enzyme, the lipoprotein lipase enzyme. The lipoprotein lipase enzyme is very important for metabolism of chylomicron and VLDL. This lipoprotein lipase enzyme is adherent to capillary endothelial wall, and this is getting activated with the help of ApoC. The C1 and C2, they are activator, and C3 is said to be inhibitor for lipoprotein lipase. Please remember, the kind of ApoC which is donated by HDL is mostly ApoC1 and C2. So that tend to activate this lipoprotein lipase enzyme, and this lipoprotein lipase enzyme attacks the triacylglycerol of the core, releases its fatty acid and distributes it to the tissues. The glycerol is shed to the blood and goes to the liver for gluconeogenesis. But this fatty acid is going to extrahepatic tissues like skeletal muscle, heart muscle, and adipose cell. Because these organ capillary mesh is having abundant quantity of lipoprotein lipase, so that is the reason that majority of the dietary triacylglycerol is able to deliver its fatty acid to these three organs. They say 80% of the fatty acid is distributed to these organs, remaining 20% of the fatty acid, which is still incorporated in the triacylglycerol of chylomicron, is returned to the liver without undergoing metabolism. That is it. This is how the chylomicron metabolism we have to revise: the nascent chylomicron, the maturation in the circulation by HDL, then action of lipoprotein lipase, which is able to deliver the fatty acid to certain specific tissues. And once this is done, the chylomicron is, you know, getting smaller in size, and that's called chylomicron remnant, which is still having 20% of the fatty acid in it, and that is given to liver. So liver is not the major consumer of dietary fatty acid, right? Rather, the skeletal muscle, heart muscle and adipose, they are the major organ which are going to utilize the dietary fatty acid. Now, the core aspect of VLDL metabolism: the VLDL is organized in the liver after taking a lot of carbohydrate. So, liver is the organ which is producing VLDL, and it's secreting into the general circulation. And yes, I have said correctly, it's a carbohydrate diet which is responsible for VLDL production, because the fatty acid which is there in the triacylglycerol of the core section of VLDL is actually the fatty acid which is produced from excessive glucose which we have consumed. So this triacylglycerol is having the fatty acid which is produced from the excessive surplus carbohydrate which we have consumed. So the concentration of VLDL vary according to the content of carbohydrate in our diet. On the other hand, as I have just told you, the content, the amount of chylomicron in the plasma is directly proportional to the lipid in the diet. But the amount of VLDL in the plasma is directly proportional to the carbohydrate content of the diet. Now, this VLDL is also having some amount of cholesterol ester in its core. And then when this nascent VLDL comes to the general circulation, this is having B100 and ApoA. And again, the same thing happens. The C and D is donated by HDL particle, which matures the VLDL, and this becomes a mature VLDL, which is capable of undergoing metabolism in the circulation with the help of LPL enzyme, that is the lipoprotein lipase enzyme. The same fashion, the ApoC is going to activate lipoprotein lipase enzyme, which is going to attack the triacylglycerol of the core, and that's going to release the fatty acid and glycerol in the blood. This fatty acid is going to permeate the tissues and going to go to the skeletal muscle, heart muscle, and adipose, as I have just described previously in this video for the chylomicron metabolism. So this VLDL, which is bringing the fatty acid produced by the liver, is getting distributed to these organs, and VLDL, which is now shrinking in size, is then called as LDL particle. So LDL is actually produced from VLDL. One VLDL is capable of producing you one LDL particle, but this LDL is not having abundant triacylglycerol, rather it is having more of the cholesterol ester in its core. And when we examine carefully the content of ApoA proteins on the LDL particle, we find that we have only B100 and ApoE. This is so because ApoA and ApoC is returned to HDL. So whatever is left on LDL particle is B100 and ApoE. This LDL is capable of delivering the cholesterol to extrahepatic tissue if they desire it. But for that, this LDL should be recognized by a receptor called LDL receptor at extrahepatic tissue. So this LDL receptor is able to identify this B100 domain, and this LDL is endocytosed within the cell. It is going to go inside by endocytosis, and there this LDL with the help of lysosomal enzyme is going to deliver the cholesterol in the cholesterol pool. And if an extrahepatic cell is not able to uptake this LDL because the LDL receptor is not shown on the surface, that time what happens, this LDL is going to go to liver and it's getting cleared off from the circulation. So this is how we discuss the LDL metabolism. You have to have a detailed information on the delivery of cholesterol in the extrahepatic tissue. So again, in nutshell, if I say how the VLDL metabolism is to be described in exam, you're going to write that it's getting organized in the liver, secreted, getting matured, and then are undergoing the metabolism by lipoprotein lipase enzyme, which is able to deliver the fatty acid to these tissues. And when the size of the VLDL is shrunk and it's like smaller in size, it is called LDL particle, which is having predominant cholesterol ester in it. And this LDL particle is either recognized by extrahepatic tissues if they have LDL receptor, or then otherwise it is cleared by the liver. That is it. This is LDL and VLDL metabolism. When I talk to you about HDL metabolism, the core aspect of HDL metabolism, if I discuss, the HDL is high density lipoprotein, and high density means it's having more of the protein, less of the lipid. And the story begins with nascent HDL particle or disc-shaped HDL particle, which is, secreted by liver and intestine. And it's a very interesting particle because it's a flattened disc-shaped structure, which is having a very little amount of cholesterol ester in the core section, and ApoE, 1, and C, and E on its surface. This kind of nascent HDL, when it comes to the circulation, it activates one enzyme called LCAT. I'm not going in detail of LCAT activity and all that, but once the A1 is activating the LCAT is able to produce a lacuna in the shell, which is going to accommodate the extrahepatic cholesterol in it. And that cholesterol is then modified to cholesterol ester, which is going to the core section. So what I say is explaining you that how the LCAT activity is, you know, helping in the reverse cholesterol transport. The extrahepatic cell cholesterol is like taken up by HDL particle, and that's ultimately getting accommodated in the core section, and that's going to produce this kind of spherical HDL particle, which is called HDL3. More and more accumulation of cholesterol in the cholesterol ester form in the HDL core further enlarges the size of HDL particle, and this becomes HDL2 particle. So this is a very interesting metabolism where the lipid is getting accumulated in the core section of the lipoprotein. It is not being donated to the tissues, rather from the tissues it is taken up, and it's a free cholesterol which is taken up from cholesterol pool, but ultimately it is modified to cholesterol ester with the help of LCAT enzyme, and then that cholesterol ester is accommodated in the core. And repeated such action of LCAT enzyme is, you know, increasing the size of HDL moment by moment, and it's like becoming HDL2, and this HDL2 is like represented to liver, and on the way at times what happens, this HDL2 is exchanging its cholesterol ester with VLDL and chylomicron and its remnant, and exchanging it for triacyl cholesterol. That and all happens, but ultimately when HDL2 is represented at the liver, in brief I tell you, this is the liver, and for ultimately when HDL2 is represented here, it is seen to have the cholesterol ester, it's seen to have triacylglycerol in the core. This tag is actually derived from exchange process which I was just describing you, and this HDL2 is either like totally getting disintegrated at the surface of liver, except ApoA1, which escapes to the general circulation. And majority of time it is like filtered in the urine, but at times it is becoming part of pre-beta HDL. But majority of time what happens, the destiny of HDL2 is that it is reconverted to HDL3 at the liver surface and sent to the circulation for starting the reverse cholesterol transport once again. This happens when some of the cholesterol ester is like taken up by hepatic cell, and the size of HDL2 is becoming smaller, and it's converted to HDL3, and all other content of the HDL remains intact in HDL3. The A1, the C and E, they all are there on HDL3, and this again comes to the general circulation for reverse cholesterol transport, where the extrahepatic tissue keeps on donating the free cholesterol to this HDL3, converting it to HDL2. So this is how a very unique kind of metabolism is there for the HDL. It all starts with the nascent particle, which is, you know, so small. So it's a flattened structure, disc-shaped structure. It's also called discoidal HDL. And this discoidal HDL, you know, gets inflated moment by moment by action of LCAT enzyme after accommodating cholesterol in the cholesterol ester form in the core. And this HDL2, when it is encountering the liver, ultimately either the liver is converting it to A1 or it's converting it to HDL3. Both ways, the system or the nature or evolution is trying to conserve this HDL particle in the circulation. So this is all about overview of lipoprotein metabolism. In next video, I discuss you something else,